desperate than you think. I wonder what it's like to be the universe, experiencing itself ironically.
Hey, I'm Ed Masley from the Arizona Republican, azcentral.com, here with John O'Callaghan of The Maine to talk about their new album, American Candy, which I had the privilege to listen to today. It sounds great.
Thank you.
So this strikes me as like a big departure, kind of. Pretty big departure from the last one, Forever Halloween. Was that part of the plan going in?
Yeah, I think it was a conscientious effort. I guess this one, for me, was the first time I kind of vocalized the end goal to the guys prior to showing them tunes. And what I mean by that is in the past, it's usually just write songs and then bring them to the table, make a record, and then figure out how that record is kind of, how it feels based on the way we recorded it, et cetera.
Right.
This time it was more so going for something with more of a bounce and a groove in mind. So right off the bat, everybody was kind of very aware, you know, drums and bass especially, Pat and Garrett, that we wanted to go for more of a bounce. And when I say bounce, I mean, you know, more of, I guess, a jovial kind of hop to the whole thing.
Right.
Whereas I feel like in, you know, especially with the most recent record, it was, you know, dressed up very somber and dark and,
right.
You know, so I think that is what people will find is the biggest difference between Forever Halloween and this
album.
Right,
so it's more upbeat.
Yeah, I think so.
It seems like you put your pop sensibilities really forward on this one, too.
Yeah, and I think that's always been kind of a constant with our songwriting. I write from a very pop-oriented place to begin with, and I feel like we, with the past few records, we've gotten pretty good at disguising that, you know, and like dressing it up as rock songs. You know, and having the luxury of having a guitar player like Jared and being able to get away with, you know, more solos in the bridge and stuff like that. I feel like we've been able to kind of stray from just the straight up pop. But in a formulaic sense, I think that the songs are all written relatively the same. Verse, chorus, bridge, chorus out, you know?
Right.
But yeah, I think we embraced that a little bit more on this record. And I think knowing that we were working with Colby Wedgeworth, who did the album, we know that he comes from a very pop, you know, pop first kind of place. So
right.
I think it complemented itself well. I guess we embraced it more so than we have before because we were confident in the message behind it. And I was confident in the lyric behind it. And I felt good about it.
So when you say the message behind it, the lyric behind it, what do you mean by that?
As far as individual songs, you know, I felt like even if I were talking about a specific person or, you know, a love or any of these themes that are kind of widely known and relatively, you know, I guess cliche for lack of a better word, but I felt like those scenarios, those topics, they were, I guess, in my mind, thought out a bit more than just, you know, 7 years ago, 8 years ago. I guess writing a lot of songs has led me to a place where I feel like I don't have to come out and be so forthright in a lot of senses. But then, you know, there's some songs when it's simply not metaphorical. It's just, you know, something that actually occurred or an instance. So I don't know. I feel like we felt more confident. And each time you make a record and you write a song, I feel like, you know, you take something away from what you didn't like or what you liked prior. And I felt like, you know, this being our fifth record, I would hope we have some sort of idea of what makes us feel good, what we're comfortable with, and a decent idea on what we think needs to be put out next. So
right.
Yeah.
Now, does embracing your pop side, does that mean you were in some way dissatisfied or whatever with the when you were disguising the pop side a little bit more on the
Well, I think, you know, just like anything else, it takes some time to get to a point where you're confident and where you're comfortable. I wasn't writing songs prior to being in this band. So the first record that we had written was kind of just off the cuff, and it just came out of nowhere. And then it was like, oh, you're thrown in and now you got to write songs, and this is what you do. So now you got to write songs that were better than the, you know. So right. It's like it was this whole manic kind of like, here you go. And just, and I feel like that's the greatest way of taking on a skill or taking on knowledge is for the most part just submerging, you know, and just really diving in and being kind of, I guess, overwhelmed. I don't know. I feel like it's taken me a bit to be really comfortable as a songwriter, and not to a sense of complacency, like I'm settling for this song to come out and that's just going to be it, but comfortable in the fact that I've used really intimate scenarios in songs. I've used really broad strokes, and I feel like the influences that I have paint, and I guess they form a lot of who we are and who I am as a songwriter. And I feel like I've found my kind of way in some senses, but I've also, you know, I attribute that a lot to people like Tom Petty and Neil Young and just the music that I was kind of grown up on.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, could you talk a little bit about the recording environment? You guys rented a house
near the Joshua Tree and converted it into a studio.
Yeah, so some of this gear that we're even using right now to record is some of the gear that we fortunately have accumulated. And, you know, with Pat's help, we've purchased an overabundance, probably, of gear that we can use at our leisure to record. So Pat had the idea of, you know, taking that gear to a place that's not Los Angeles and not Nashville and not, you know, these places that we've done albums in, something a bit more unique. So it was probably Pat or, you know, somebody that had the idea of Joshua Tree. I think some of it had to do with the influence of the Rolling Stones and probably, like, you know, the late 60s, early 70s of, like, the Joshua Tree Inn and, you know, Keith Richards finding himself in the desert and, like, you know, just really hunkering down. So being disconnected, I think, helped a lot just in a focus sense as far as this is what you're doing. You only have 30 days. We only rented the house for 30 days. So we knew the parameter set. We knew that we had to make an album within that time frame. And so we just kind of shut off everything and just made the album.
Yeah.
It was really nice too, yeah. I mean, there wasn't any internet. So it wasn't like we were like completely roughing it. You know, we had electricity and right. We had TV, but
you had your phones with
yeah,
you.
Yeah. But right. For the most part it was really just about, I mean, it was 12-hour, 13-hour work days sometimes. But that's what I mean, especially having somebody that wants to work like that with you in Colby. That's what we do, like, that's what we love doing, and it doesn't feel like work at that point, so.
Right.
And we're used to the desert, but not like that, because we're, you know, you got to see the stars, which isn't something that we really get to do here in the
right,
valley,
yeah.
So. It was a really cool place, for sure.
Now, was the album all written before you went there?
Yeah, so for the most part, we had everything kind of stamped out. There's always, like, you know, the things that you leave up to the spirit of the studio and the spirit of the moment to kind of dictate the next step. But we did pre-production for about a week and a half prior.
Yeah.
And we knew, again, we knew the time frame. We knew we had 30 days. And actually, there was a point when we had about 14 tracks that, you know, I was coming home every night after pre-production and, like, you know, either really worrying about, you know, are these songs fully intact? Like, do I see the potential? And we ended up having a discussion one of the days, maybe 3 days out, where we just ended up scrapping and deciding to cut songs that we knew we didn't really fully commit to, I guess, internally. So it was like some non, you know, we didn't have that emotional, I guess, connection to a couple of the tunes. And that's when we just decided, all right, we're doing 10 songs. And, you know, it was a big decision because in the past we've always kind of just said, we can make these B-sides or you know, here's all this time. We have ample amounts of time. And I think that this time we really set out to make the best record we possibly could, knowing that we only were doing 10 songs. So
yeah, so you only recorded those.
Yeah, we wanted to make it more of an experience from start to finish. And I suppose that might clash with the way that music is digested now.
Yeah.
But for us, I think creatively, it was really fulfilling because, you know, you create... We don't want to just create singles. We don't want to create one single song. And like I was talking about before, it was like, you know, you don't want to, you don't want to create one song or you know, 10 songs and then feel like, oh, we have to put that in the album because we recorded it.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
So we knew what we wanted to do, and I feel like we got close to what we set out to, if not accomplished it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But now you can't do the deluxe edition with outtakes.
Yeah, anything. No, but see, but now we have the gear, so we just move that gear into another house and we just record, cut the other tunes. So I guess that was part of our excuse as well.
Yeah. Well, let's go through and talk about the tracks. Did something in particular inspire the writing of Miles Away? And how did you decide to make that the opening track? I guess that's two questions in one.
What inspired it was a trip that I took. I took a train for the first time, save for like the Grand Canyon trip that you take where like cowboys run alongside of it and commandeer the train. I took that when I was probably 8 or 9. But I hadn't been on a train since. And so I took the Amtrak. Coast Starlight runs from Los Angeles to San Francisco.
Yeah.
And it was like the last trip that I had to take before I really started writing. And I was going to see Tom Petty in San Francisco at Outside Lands.
Oh, yeah.
So it was like this whole weekend that I had already kind of planned out and set up. And... yeah, the song's really just about that 3-day trip, and I guess more so than anything, it started to, you know, that summer prior, we met some people on Warped Tour that were just very contagious in their personalities in such a great way, in such an influential way that it really had me thinking from when that tour stopped to even when that trip was going on that. You know, a lot of your personality and whatever you're exuding is really, you know, it really does affect people. So I had that kind of in mind. And, you know, going from San Francisco, which was one of my favorite cities in the world, to coming back to Arizona, which is home, you know, I tried to kind of bring that back with me. And I feel like that's what the song really, I guess that was my attempt in trying to kind of convey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how did you decide to make it the opening track?
The opening track, I don't even know. I feel like the guitar riff, to be honest, was really kind of what influenced it. It just felt like it set some sort of tone. And I guess that the lyric as well, I feel like that song, excuse me, in particular, is kind of like a roller coaster ride in that... Whenever I listen to it, I kind of forget where the song started when I reach the end. And I hope that that's kind of the same way it is when somebody listens to the record, is that you kind of forget how it started, but you know you liked it and you know you enjoyed it.
Yeah.
So it makes you kind of want to revisit that. And I feel like that's what we tried to accomplish with the record Yeah, I guess there's got to be a first song.
Right, yeah. You know, I really like two things about the second track, Same Suit, Different Tie. The lyrics and the guitar sound, which kind of reminds me of The Edge a little bit.
Okay.
I was wondering, like, if you could talk about what inspired both the sound of that and the lyrics of it?
The lyric obviously kind of coincides with us being a band for so long, and making records, and you know, you're consistently making music, and I feel like, you know, each time we put on and we dress it up just a little bit differently, and I feel like it's very important for us as a band to make it known to whoever's you know, on the receiving end of the album that this is a new experience. So all the while we've remained, I suppose, pretty close to the dudes that we were when we started. I'd like to think so.
Yeah.
So I guess with the lyric, it's just about the evolution of the band and I think us as individuals. But it's more so about kind of that life being breathed back into the whole thing. You know, this being our fifth record, I think we could have easily just kind of made, I don't know what we could have made and not been excited about it. Fortunately, that wasn't the case. So the sound, I guess, the demo of the song was just an acoustic that I was playing with some like beat on this organ machine that I have in my room. And everybody enjoyed the feeling that we got when we listened to it. But whenever we tried to really bring it to the full band experience, it just kind of fell flat.
Yeah.
And there was part of it that kind of sounded like Fleetwood Mac, but not in a good way. And it felt like it might have been too old for us. And like something that we probably wouldn't intuitively do. It was like something that we were forcing to sound like Fleetwood Mac. So I felt like we brought it back a little bit. I guess we tried to balance that timeless feeling in the verse and the intros with kind of more of the modern twist in the chorus. Very straightforward guitars.
Yeah, it gets crunchy.
Yeah, and you know, like a Killers kind of vibe. Yeah. But yeah, I think that's a big departure from what we would have done in the past, especially Garrett on the bass. I feel like the bass moves in a way that I've never heard kind of us, I guess, move it before. So
right,
yeah, I'm pretty excited with the way it turned out.
Yeah, sounds great.
Thank you.
Now, I love the lyrics in my hair. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, yeah.
What you were going for with that.
Yeah, I mean, so prior to having these locks, I had I had grown my hair out for the longest it's ever been. And I don't know why I did it to begin with. I felt like part of it was just I guess because we're so fortunate to be a band and play music for what we call a living, that I felt like I wanted to embrace that in more than just making music. And I guess I started to grow out the hair, and then I started to catch a lot of shit along the way.
Right.
From people that didn't really enjoy the way I looked.
Yeah.
And so it made me really like, screw you, like anarchy, kind of like,
right,
I'm not
going
to tell you, you know, I'm not going to do what you tell me to do. And then I balanced that out with like, okay, I'm going to cut it when the record's done. So then it was like more of a, all right, now you're like more of like a, all right, you're going to not look greasy once this thing's finished,
right,
kind of
yeah.
thing. But more so, more than anything, it's about not giving in to the structures, the restrictions of everybody, and I guess letting it just fly. I mean, I think Crosby, Stills, and Nash has a song called "Cut My Hair."
Yeah, they do.
And it's like, I guess it's the similar vibe. It's just embracing who you are and embracing your weirdness and embracing the individual, I guess, inside.
Yeah. It is kind of funny that all those years later, people are still getting grief for the way they're
right.
They're
yeah.
Their hair.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I don't know.
How did you decide on English Girls as the single? That's the first single, right?
Yeah. I think the mood of that song kind of represents the mood of the album. If you had to pick one song in particular, I feel like that one would do the best in describing the album as a whole without listening to the other tracks. The experience itself was supposed to be, you know, just an innocent kind of depiction of an experience that happened when one of the first times that we were in England. And it's really just a straightforward story to something that happened outside of a nightclub. And it's kind of strange to think about it now after the fact, because a lot of the songs that I've written aren't straightforward. Yeah. You know, or at least even like My Hair can have some deeper meaning or more broad meaning or what have you. And I feel like this one is one of the only songs I can recall that is really just straightforward. It is what it is. And I guess in the sense of kind of the sonic qualities of the album, it feels the most right, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
It feels like pretty close to as on the nose as we could have gotten with the discussion that we had before we wrote for the album and before we recorded the album. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Now, if that song best exemplifies the upbeat vibe of the album,
yeah.
I guess the next song would be like the opposite, right? The 24
yeah, yeah.
floors.
Absolutely.
And, you know, so yeah, did something in particular inspire that?
Yeah, I mean, it was not a good time. I'm 26 now, I was probably 23. I didn't want to play this track for my mom because I didn't want her to think like things were bad now. But I guess it just kind of documents the struggle with growing up and growing, being confused and being lost and being feeling like you're helpless and there is no hope. Yeah, I don't know. It's kind of a tough one because I don't really. It's better that I'm on the other side of it, and
right.
You know, I feel like the song. Hopefully, it's if somebody feels the same way as I'm talking and as you know as voiced in the song, hopefully they find, I guess solace in knowing that you're not, you know, you're not alone. You're not alone in the idea that you're confused and freaked out, and so
yeah,
it's probably one of the more I guess intimate songs on the record.
Yeah, so it's not like you're not singing in character. That's based on feelings that you have.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
Yeah, no. I feel like that is the closest to my headspace in not my headspace in the sense of like emotions, but my headspace in the sense of writing for Forever Halloween. I feel like that is very similar to the stance and what I wanted to give away and what I wanted to actually include personally. And
yeah.
I feel like that's the one on the record that does it the most.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the song after that, Soda Society, Diet Soda Society, it's one of my favorites on the record. I know the girl tells you to shut up and drink your diet soda, but what does that actually mean, Diet Soda Society? Does it mean something?
So I tried to write the song from this weird perspective. I came up with the chorus on piano, and whenever I pictured the song lyric and the words, I always pictured like a Woody Allen kind of character at a diner sitting across from a girl and kind of like, you know, the existential kind of like meltdown within a public setting to where, you know, like the uncertainty of life and then, you know, while eating dinner in this like really like this is what it is kind of scenario.
Yeah.
And more so the girl just kind of being like, why can't you just accept your grilled cheese for what it is kind of thing,
right.
You know, like the world just spins kind of thing. So I guess it's really that dual kind of mode of thinking where it's like, you know, why do the stars shine? And
right.
then like, why does soda have carbonation? And then it's just like, yeah. So I guess it's partly thinking like the diet soda aspect is I guess her position, where it's like, I'm just going to take things at face value and not really question anything. And then the other position would be maybe going over the top with your analysis and your pondering of everything, and maybe to a fault. So, yeah, it's a fun one.
Yeah,
definitely.
So are you closer to the girl or the guy in that situation?
I would say I'm somewhere in the middle.
Yeah,
I would say sometimes I'm on both ends of the spectrum.
Yeah,
I'd probably lean more towards the guy's end at times. But yeah, I think I fall somewhere evenly.
Yeah. So the self-doubts you express in Am I Pretty, how personal is that?
That one's not very personal to me, at least at this point. I feel like being in the position that I've been in for the past 8 years, like being on stage and being, you know, kind of in charge of dictating shows or what have you, I feel like it's brought a side out of me that probably wasn't there in the past. But I haven't felt uncomfortable, I guess, in a lot of scenarios for a while. The song really stems from my kind of, I guess, my not being able to conceive like or to like really understand how hard it would be to grow up in the era of like the internet, as far as like being born with an iPad in your hand,
right,
or you know, and I feel like a lot of it comes from this, like the judgment that's so easily passed from the comforts of a computer chair. You know, I feel like there's always been kind of like that, you know, this is how you should look and this is how you should act. But I feel like now that everybody has a voice, it's got to be so tough to be, you know, a teenager or I mean, it's tough enough to just be, you know, 26. But, you know, my youngest brother, I just remember him going through high school and you know, girls with Facebook and then, you know, there somebody said something mean, so then now the parents step in and it's like, well, she was posting risque photos at like age, you know, whatever. And
right.
It's just like, oh my gosh. Like, so a lot of it was bewilderment on my end. Like, I don't know who I would be, because I don't necessarily really enjoy a lot of that Facebook and stuff like that. So
yeah.
I feel like I don't know who I would be put in their shoes. And the bridge really is a reminder that you don't need others' kind of approval. And you know, the flaws in you know, our makeup is what makes us really great. The individuality that kind of, you know, my crooked teeth from not wearing my retainer, I feel like that I embrace that now, and it took me a while to really get to that point. So it's really, I think overall it's really a message of you should be good with who you are and
right.
not search for the approval of others.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you gotten your parents to embrace that you didn't wear your retainer yet?
No, my mom is pissed, man. She always says it too. I spent thousands of dollars for you to have crooked bottom teeth. So whatever. I tell her it's how I set myself apart.
Yeah, the title track is another one of my favorites on the album, and I was wondering what appealed to you about using that as the title track.
Well, I think sonically it kind of, I think, really brings out that rock aspect of the band that we really love and that we really used as a disguise prior. For a
right.
lot of songs, for a lot of the pop stuff. So I feel like that one really kind of is is a song for hopefully a lot of people that fell in love with that aspect of our band. Hopefully that's their track on American Candy. I guess the way it kind of coincides with the title of the album is just kind of the... And I really wanted to make it so that the album title didn't necessarily thematically clump every song in
right.
in with it, with its meaning. I guess the meaning is really just my distaste for modern American kind of culture in the sense of things being force-fed and kind of that diet soda kind of approach
right.
to a lot of things. I guess the way that I justified using that as the title for the album was keeping that in mind while writing the songs and making sure that the songs all came from some earnest place, some real, tangible, whether they were something that I experienced or some concept that I wanted to kind of, you know, touch on. I really tried to make sure that everything came from some place of sincerity. And American Candy is just kind of posing the question of, again, do things need to be the way that they were, you know, kind of fed to you?
Right.
Yeah. And I feel like it's the part that, in the record, that is kind of like, hey, we didn't lose our balls kind of thing. Like, we still have very much the ability to kind of riff and to play loud guitars. So,
yeah. So the candy is a metaphor, though, on this.
Oh, yeah. Right. Absolutely. It came from, actually, what's funny is we were in Australia, and I was walking, I feel like it was with Garrett, and we passed a liquor store, and outside the liquor store it said American Candy, 99 cents, or whatever it was. And the title just kind of still resonated with me when I got home, because then I started thinking, excuse me, of it in the terms of like I just explained.
Yeah.
What is that to people? Like, if you could explain American culture, it would be probably gluttony and, you know, consuming in excess and you know, kind of very self, you know, me
instant
first.
Gratification.
Exactly, instant gratification. And I tried to combat that with the writing from the start, and that's kind of what that song entails.
Yeah. Now you sign off with like kind of a curveball. That song is really. I love that song.
Thank you.
It's definitely one of my favorites, if not my favorite. It sounds like it's not really as much of a piece with the other song.
Yeah,
you
absolutely.
Talk about what you were going for there.
I feel like it actually came from a demo that I had that I included in the long list of demos that I sent out. To the guys, and I forget who kind of brought it to the table, but for me it was always something that I felt like would never find a place. And you know, that's the great thing about working in a dynamic that's not just me. And I think that's the great thing about being in a band and being in this band is, you know, something that I would have probably let go a long time ago came and resurfaced on you know, this album. And it just so happened that, like, you know, I guess things aligned and the concept that I had worked with the music of the demo. And so, you know, that's the great thing about working with other people is there might be stuff that you just forget about that have a place, but you just kind of dismissed.
Yeah. Yeah, I really like that song.
Thank you.
It's a great way to end the record, you know. I like when the album ends with something that's kind of like
a song
you didn't see coming.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Anyhow, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks for doing this.
Oh, no problem.
That was fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're done.
Awesome. They've got American candy.